Stonehouse, Dartford, Kent. To the London Metropolitan Police Force. Sirs. After leaving my studies at the Royal College of Music in London, July 1921, I returned to Gloucester.
One of the main challenges in this project for me as a composer was to select which aspect of Gurney's life I wanted to highlight. There is Gurney, the composer, the poet, the creative genius. There is Gurney, the mental patient. There is Gurney, the soldier in the First World War. I decided not to take any of those aspects as the main theme, but to take Gurney the walker. Gurney was an obsessive walker all his life. For him, I believe, the walking fulfilled two main purposes. One was to stay one step ahead of his psychotic condition by being frantically active. And the second one was to suck in all the influences of the natural beauty that he saw around him and to use that as inspiration for his music and for his poetry.
After which I lived mostly with my aunt at 1 Westfield Terrace and partly on her kindness, working hard, staying up long hours, and being active, digging, walking, cycling, digging, walking, cycling, digging, walking, cycling, digging, walking, cycling.
Walking is, of course, the most primitive way of getting from A to B. I mean, before there were airplanes and cars, you had to use your own 2 feet, which is great because, you know, they give you a beat. And that's why there's a lot of songs about walking, or why walking wants to make you sing. And all the composers knew it. I mean, Schubert wrote great walking songs. There's Wolf, there's Duparc, there's, you know, you name it. Ivor Gurney, also, great walking composer.
Another important aspect in my piece is the use of memories. Memories were very important for Gurney when he was incarcerated in his mental institution. He couldn't go out of the gate, and he had to relive his walking tours in his head. I have used memories in my piece in a slightly different way, namely by quoting work of the famous leader composers of the 19th century, people like Schubert and Hugo Wolf.
René is kind of an old soul, as they say. He's got his own voice and still is part of a big tradition. He really writes music about music. Out of this piece came a whole program that's kind of about the same theme, with René's new piece as a beautiful centerpiece.
From rehearsing with René and working together with René, the three of us, then started to see the potential for expanding the theatricality of this particular work, of his work. And from his work, the idea kind of grew to encompass the entire program. And so we started thinking about reading poems, we started thinking about adding visuals, we started thinking about adding some solo piano pieces also, all to kind of highlight this theme.
Again, returning to London,
I think this is a really exciting project because it has so many sides. It feels like 5D, you know? We're so used to being on the stage, put on your suit, sing your songs, people will applaud, and that's it. And now, you're no longer the piano player, I'm no longer the singer. And there's this other guy on the stage somewhere, and you know, there are the words floating around, and René is with us everywhere we go, and we have a toy piano and stones and a soundtrack. So it's, I mean, this show is just all over the place.